Good evening, everyone. Hello, Durban. In the absence, I'd like to acknowledge the Vice Chancellor of the University of KwaZulu-Natal, Mr. Albert van Jaarsveld, Professor Albert van Jaarsveld, all the Deputy Vice Chancellors, with in particular the Deputy Vice Chancellor of the Faculty of Humanities, Professor Cheryl Potgieter, members of the executive, deans, school managers, and other academics who will be here. I'd like to acknowledge the City of Durban, particularly Mr. Thembinkosi Ngcobo, the Head of Parks, Recreations, and Culture, his deputy, Mr. Guy Redmond. I'd also, I think in his absence, like to acknowledge a very dear friend of the festival, Mr. Eric Applegreen, the Head of International Governance and Relations, and Mr. Linda Mbonambi, the Head of Area-Based Management, which I think is a new unit in the municipality. I'd like to acknowledge the KwaZulu-Natal Department of Arts and Culture, particularly Mr. Mpumelelo Mnguni and Mr. Alpha Ngcobo. I'd like to acknowledge the National Arts Council and Mr. Andrew Nkadimeng, who's traveled all the way to be here with us, as well as the incoming chairperson of the council, Mr. David Mwamahlamela. And all other members of the council who are here. I'd like to acknowledge all of our loyal and supportive partners, former participants who've come to celebrate this year's edition of Poetry Africa, going back the last 18 years. I think that's all. I'd like to acknowledge you for coming out and making this a thing. Thank you very much. My name is Tiny Mungwe. I'm a project manager at the Center for Creative Arts. It's a non-academic unit in the University of KwaZulu-Natal's Humanities Faculty under the School of Art. It's also a special project of Professor Cheryl Potgieter, the Deputy Vice Chancellor of the Faculty of Humanities. We are able to put on this festival with generous support from eThekwini Municipality, Parks, Recreation and Culture, National Arts Council, the KwaZulu-Natal Department of Arts and Culture, the Goethe Institute, and others who I will mention in more detail later. But particularly a partner that I'd like to talk about now is Adams Books, which is headed by Cedric Sissing, who is a champion of literature, a champion of writers, and a connoisseur of books. He's got a stand out in the back. Please be sure to go there and support, but also enrich your own life with his collection of books and literature. We are also running a book drive in the course of this week. So as you come in the course of the week, please, you can buy a book there and donate, or you can give some of the books that you have loved very well through the years to someone else who'll be needy. So, before we start talking about the overview of the festival, I'd like to invite on stage the Acting Dean in the School of the Arts, Professor Donald McCracken, to welcome you to the University of KwaZulu-Natal.
Thank you very much indeed. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Potgieter asked me to extend a warm welcome to you. The festival falls under CCA, which is in the School of Arts, which is the most creative school in the university, and probably also the most troublesome school in the university. I was asked to speak at lunchtime, so I haven't really thought about what to say, but one thing did strike me, and that was that it's now 50 years since I was at school. And I remember there were only three ways that you could get to the annual prize giving at my old school back home in Ireland. One was to work hard, which really wasn't an option for me. The second was to be a bit of a lickspittle to one of the lecturers, the teachers, which I really wasn't fussed with. But the third was to enter the headmaster's poetry prize, because we had an Englishman as a headmaster who was very, very keen to encourage the Irish to write poetry. You know, not that we knew about writing poetry. And so if you entered a poem, you automatically got a prize, which meant you automatically were allowed to go up on stage and be important. So I thought tonight it would be a very nice thing to read to you one of the poems which I got a prize for 52 years ago. Unfortunately, when I went home to put on a jacket, I said to my wife, you know, where is that old tin where I kept my poetry? Now, I've been married to her for 35 years. So what she said came as a very great shock. You don't really know people, do you? She said, I burnt them. I burnt them. I mean, the only thing that equals this tragedy is when the poet Byron, you remember he wrote an autobiography. And when he died, which one doesn't really have much say in, but when he died, his literary executor, who was a scoundrel publisher called John Murray, even more scoundrelish than most publishers, burnt it. He burnt his autobiography because he said it was vile, which meant it was a good read. And I don't know whether my poetry was good or vile. We shall never know. All I know is one line from one of the poems, and it read, I picked a single primrose from his grave. There was a, we're on an Irish theme. There's a novelist, I don't suppose anyone reads them nowadays, called George A. Birmingham. And he wrote about 1910, 1920 sort of period. Wonderful, wonderful short story writer. And here's a wonderful story about a man named Brendan O'Donoghue. And Brendan O'Donoghue did what a lot of the Irish do and had to leave the country. He went to London, where every Friday night he had a gathering of faithful from the home sod for poetry readings. And they would sit and they would read the more obscure verses of W.B. Yeats, in particular relation to the pagan soul of Ireland. And it became very famous. And when O'Donoghue was old, he was asked, you know, is there anything he wouldn't do for Ireland? And he said, no, there was nothing I would do for Ireland, nothing at all, except actually live there. when I was at school, poetry had to rhyme, or it had to be funny. I don't know whether I see there's one possible savior on the agenda, I think things have moved on a little bit. Anyway, as I've got nothing to say and no poetry, and I think I'd better sit down. Formerly, the University of KwaZulu-Natal is 44,000 students, of which 19,000 come from the humanities art. These are the schools, which, if you have any young ones, or if you're thinking of having any young ones, we're offering a special rate tonight on fees. Just ask for the poetry special. I incidentally noted the young gentleman. I'm in charge of music for my sins, and I noticed the young gentleman complaining about, you know, income. And I must put a new model, a new module on the music syllabus: how to earn money. Ladies and gentlemen, I think it's a wonderful program. I wish you well. I'm very pleased to see, especially the out-of-town people, the people from abroad here, and a very warm welcome to you, and please enjoy the festival. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Prof. That was great. Next up, I'd like to request a few words from the head of Etigwini Municipality's Parks, Recreation and Culture Unit, Mr. Thembinkosi Ngobo.
Thanks, Tiny. Greetings to the acting dean and the leadership of this institution, my colleagues from the city and also the province, and to our assets, the writers that are here. We are grateful to be part of this great event as a seat of Etegwini. Our view is that, just like other people have reflected before, there is nothing more important than words. Even the great book does recognize that. Karl Marx made some remarks about that. But then the most important for me is what Desmond Tutu said the other day, that when you are involved in an argument, do not raise your voice, but improve your argument. You, through the words that on daily basis you craft and send messages to us as custodians of power and governance, do tell us to reflect on a regular basis so that we don't find ourselves abusing that power that is put in trust to us. The biggest reason why this country has been having conflicts for the last 400 years is because there were certain ideas which were deemed to be too dangerous or unimportant to be aired. And the reason why, for instance, after 1994 or before that, we fought and a number of people died was so that we could get a space for us to circulate those ideas. And therefore, for us, this festival, the Festival of Ideas, goes very deep into our fundamental values as government, this new government, that no matter how much we disagree with you, but we'll go all out to ensure that those words that you have against or for us do get a space to be circulated. That's part, therefore, of the reason, and we're very excited about this, that our city 2 weeks ago took a resolution that we're going to increase our involvement in this festival from 1 million rands to 4 million rands. And we're hoping that this is going to assist in entrenching this festival. As a city, we have every year a budget of just more than 10 million rands for the acquisition of books. We also run one of the biggest networks of libraries in the city. We are forever engaging and reflecting as to how much we can use this such that the biggest part of that slice of budget will go towards the acquisition of local books. I'm talking about national books, whether it written by somebody from Johannesburg or Devon, that we prioritize those books because in our view, those books are more relevant, those ideas are more relevant and nearer to our experiences than books that could have been written elsewhere. We'll still need those books from elsewhere. But we believe that from now on, people should be able to live on the basis of their skills and craft, which is poetry. In conclusion, this city makes a commitment that the last few years we've been involved in this, and our view is that we're going to be involved to eternity because we appreciate and your ideas make us alive. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ngobo. So the Center for Creative Arts organizes this festival, as well as Time of the Writer in March, which is a festival of writers and also ideas. In June, July, we organize the Durban International Film Festival, and in August, September, we organize the Jamba Festival. So we really appreciate the support that we're getting from the city because it ensures that we are able to host these four festivals in the next 3 years to come. So thank you very much. And I think it's really important what you've said about the importance of poetry because for many reasons, I think poetry will remain relevant to us in the city and this whole country. Poetry allows anybody to be able to voice their thoughts and their opinions. It allows us all to make a record of our lived experiences, a kind of record that I think travels much further than a literary, like a book, and is able to reach a lot more people. It's a kind of form that shapes itself to be more easily suitable to anybody's needs, what language you use, and it allows us room to build bridges with each other. So I think this is why this week is important, and this is why these 24 people's work is important. I will stop talking because I know that you all came here to listen to other people who are professionals at that. So I'll get going with that. But before I do, I'd just like to give you an overview of what we'll be doing this week and how you can be a part of it. Every evening, there'll be 6 poets doing a presentation of 20 minutes each here on the stage at the Elizabeth Sneddon Theatre. There are flyers in the foyer, and you can be able to see the program, the day-to-day program, and be able to pick the shows that you'd like to see. We hope you come to all of them. We try to mix it up so that you have a reason every night. During the day, for all their sins, we take these poets to schools, community centers, campuses, and we've organized with a lot of community-based organizations and event organizers to have poetry exchanges, poetry readings, sessions, and discussions around poetry during the day. So you can be able to see the public events as well in the flyer. The school visits are not, because they are not so public. On Saturday, at the DUT courtyard, we'll be having a showcase of poetic theater. One of our festival participants, Kat Franco, will be presenting a one-woman show called Raising Lazarus. And there will be another show, bred here in Durban, Aiden's Rose, which is written by Thuli Zuma and someone else. I only found out a few hours ago someone else, and I'm sorry I've forgotten. So please will you pass the message that I do know that someone else co-wrote that play. I just don't remember who it is. It's performed by Kwazi Langisa, who's on the lineup for this year's edition, and Paige Ngwenya, who was on last year's festival and a very well-known person to the poetry community here. At the same time, at number 8 Morrison Road, which is in the new Rivertown precinct downtown, we'll be having a series of book launches, about 4 poetry books that we're launching. And in between, we'll be also offering open mic opportunities. So anybody can come and grab a mic and share poetry and see how audiences like your poetry. Just up the road from there is the Rivertown Beer Hall, which is the municipality's property where the art collection of the Durban Art Gallery is housed. They also have a gallery in there in which we'll have workshops, 4 workshops on event organizing, arts development, where there'll be representatives from National Arts Council and the Etugini Municipality, as well as finding your voice. Those are free to enter, so we invite everyone to join us. From 4 o'clock, we'll be having the annual Durban Slam Jam, which is a showcase, or rather a competition showcase of slam poetry. And then we'll be hosting the prize giving for the Sol Plaatje European Union Awards, which are organized by Jacana. And after that, we'll have another panoramic view of the poetry that we've had to offer for the week. And then we'll have the festival finale, which is going to be a riveting performance by Nakane Turi. So that is how this week is going to look. We really hope that you'll join us. Tickets here are 40 Rand and 25 Rand for students and pensioners. And at Beer Hall on the Saturday from 4 o'clock, it's 90 Rand or 80 Rand. 70 Rand. And 80 Rand at the door. You can buy tickets at CompuTicket. Okay, so let us begin with the presentation of the poets. It's going to be in alphabetical order by first name. So first up, I'd like to call Sboniso Dlamini, as his mother knows him, but most of you will know him as Africa. He's a Durban-based poet. Welcome.
Poetry Africa, what's up? Is everyone good? Yeah. My name is, that's my government name, Africa Sboniso Dlamini. It is my real surname. I mean, my real name, Africa. That is my name. So. No, it's okay. People have a hard time believing it as well. So I have to carry my ID around for it. Our mothers are township loudmouths who lashed us with their tongues, drunk and hung over and vulgar when they address us. We are similes put together clumsily, like picture frames hung carelessly on the peeling walls of their past. Clinging bottles of happy drunkards, empty stomachs for the young ones, so we knew too well not to fuck with our last pieces of bread. Now this one is for them. It's for these kids who have crumbled to their knees trying not to fall apart. All they see in their dreams are dead end signs, born into a world where silence is bliss and ignorance is golden. But see, these are kids hell-bent. They have been burping flames since they were infants. They know 1,000 ways to kill a conscience. The cracks of broken families. And some of them have made peace with the idea that we are massacres happening, we are civil wars breaking, how we line up each day to be crucified, soldiers in the front line. This war cost too much after combats, like we were made with empty guns as our arms. We are the freeborns. We have at least a century of slavery rusting our shoulder blades. At the age of 11, Temba witnessed his father melting along with his screams in a pot full of boiling gold. Imagine his run back home, where he told his family that he wants to carve diamonds for a living. And of course, no grieving mother understood what this even meant, but these are dreams never granted enough sleep, plastered on corner streets like collage, waiting on failing economic systems. Always remember to be your mother's daughter. And never forget yourself in the presence of others. These are her father's words. Her father was too noble of a countryman, with hopes that could build monuments. He spoke to her like he looked up to her. And one day she witnessed her father get arrested for protecting his wife from a police beating. On that day she saw all the colors of our national flags, and she personally thinks it is too colorful for a blindfold. Because on that day, she saw her father's pride get torn like a mother's skin, and she knew that revolution is not for the faint-hearted, and sometimes respect is taken and complacence is deadly. But these are kids raised by bastards and abandoned by mother sunsets. So tell me, noble statesmen, how dare you kill their dreams with petty illusions of freedom? We have, what, 5 minutes, right? Bloated egos still feed on humble pies. Campaigning logos claiming to improve human life. So deep in they go in our pockets for funds. Nepotism and corruption buried under a pile of laws amended for such. Now you see, rumors have always been an alibi for the absence of the truth, because the truth was long convicted and sentenced 25 to lie in the voice boxes of the voiceless. Revolution won't be televised. Or perhaps the revolution was long televised in the eyes of a son who just saw his father get shot for his views. And what his fragile mind fails to comprehend is how his mom is going to take this, and how his family has to scramble for food. And so throwing stones at a bulletproof tank is the only piece of retribution close enough to his satisfaction. Meanwhile, in the newsroom, a fat cat is being paid for his biased views. Now, it's not only wooden mics of idols, but also injustice gets commercialized for ratings.
So, one of the things about this lineup, one of the things we aim to do in this lineup is to invite new voices to come and be part of Poetry Africa, or young voices, whichever is more favorable. But yes, so I'm glad you like that. And Africa, just because I'm going to share this with you and everybody else, my name the government name, Tiny Patience Mungwe. So I feel your pain. And often very apt. My patience is often very tiny. So next up, I'd like to call a project of the African Noise Foundation, Mr. Arian Kaganath, all the way from Cape Town.
For generations in this country, we know that mediocre white men have found their place onto stages like this for no other reason that they are white. This system known as white economic empowerment has been enforced for hundreds of years. And I'd like to add my name to that list of mediocre white men. So humbly, I give you a poem that it has taken me 51 years to actualize, and it only happened on the bus today, sitting next to somebody who had a great impact on me today. Makosazana Qaba gave me the title of this poem, and in the title was the realization and understanding of how to perform it. The title is Shut Up, White Man, Please.
No, we get the best mediocre white men to come down here. And thank you, Arian, because you've just bequeathed someone with 3 minutes. Next up, I'd like to call Qelusa Majali, who is a literary writer as well as a poet, also a person very closely linked to the festival. For the past three years, Qelusa Majali has been going to prison twice. No, it would be 6 times in the year, 8 with the actual times of the festival. Not because she's naughty, but because she goes there to teach creative writing to inmates in the youth center at the prison on behalf of the Center for Creative Arts and in preparation for each of our festivals, Time of the Writer and Poetry Africa. Qelusa Majali, please.
Molweni? Sanibonani? Okay, as introduced, ndinguceliso kwaMajali. Unfortunately, novel yam is not outside with Stand, but if you visit a website, Vivlia Publishers, you definitely will be able to purchase my novel. Thank you. A poem ends and this way, sharing El Klesha is titled My Parents. A soft voice, yet laden with hatred, I heard him curse. If he cannot have her, no one else should. Convinced there is no life left to explore, not in the same planet with such a bitter misogynist. She took her last sip on life, died in his arms. Restless I was, blaming my mother for making us live a fatherless life. He cannot be that bad. How else were we conceived? I concluded, wished I never knew my own mother and father. They turned into best enemies like cats and rats. That became my uninvoiced, inevitable thought, even in green parks filled with swings. My mother lived in a dark, locked cell. Maybe without me and my twin, maybe she could have escaped her stinking prison. There we were, daily reminding her of our yearning to hold hands with her and our dearest absent father.
There we were, daily reminding her of her life choices. Her well ran dry. She stopped telling 12-year-old twins a fable of a monster, a devil she escaped a bullet from while transporting caring twins to Earth. We wanted a life with an absent father, rejected the twice hard work of an aunt. Our friends had perfect families, we believed. We wanted that for ourselves. Not until the day we went to pick fresh flowers from the dense forest. A long lost, a tall, a muscular man, the giant himself, my father, appeared. I and my twin froze as ice. See, he exuded hatred flames. Who would wait to be consumed by such wildfire? We paused. My mother begged, kill me. Let innocent children, the only evidence we became one, our product live. We shivered, turned into motionless stones watching, our heartbeats beating like drums of hope for reconciliation. A detrimental, the fatal situation we realized we confronted. We bowed our knees in the bush, leaned forward, intent gaze yet so shaken. A happy, perfect family we only wanted. A happy ever after, a fairy tale never meant for us. Our sunset settled. The gloom of midnight promised to haunt us forever. Parents who gave us a chance to life became our life imprisonment without parole. A soft voice yet laden with hatred. I heard him curse. If he cannot have her, no one else should. Convinced there is no life left to explore, not in the same planet with such a bitter misogynist. My mother took her last sip on life, died in my father's arms. I still wonder what kind of love kills.
Gentlemen from a province that we currently call the Free State, town of Bloemfontein, I found my Kelly.
I slept and dreamt of River Nile, woke up and saw it live when she smiled. I slept and dreamt of River Nile, woke up and saw it live when she smiled. I witnessed this River Nile, I saw Queen of Sheba live, slides of Makeda signs, Miriam Makeba's young vibes. I discovered definitions of fine, and to me, that's how beauty is defined. It starts from the mind, the soul, the spirit, then to the smile. Only when she smiled, even miles away from my eyes, I still visualized the smile. I slept and dreamt of River Nile, woke up and saw it live when she smiled. I witnessed this river live, I saw Queen of Sheba live, lights of Makeda signs, Miriam Makeba's young vibes. I discovered definitions of fine, and to me, that's how beauty is defined. It starts from the mind, the soul, the spirit, then to the smile. Only when she smiled. Sanbonani. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank the Center for Creative Arts at this university, beautiful university, very unique with this program that I've been following for many years, and I never thought that one day I would be here as part of it. Uh,
but throughout this week, words shall be spoken. With inspiration drawn from the hills, the valleys, the trees, the seas, but now the streets. Poetry Africa stage is now the field of expression in a format of a thunderclap explosions. As a result of these verses that scream to hell with destruction, explosives are now wrapped and sealed in metaphors and breaded perfectly on tongue motions, swift as sound of oceans. Explosives shall burst in a flammable boom, boom verses. When time is right, word shall be spoken. When time arrives, word shall be a token of these chains broken in the ears of the chosen. And word shall be spoken at Poetry Africa throughout this week. Word shall be a token of these chains broken into the ears of the chosen. Word.
Word up, Mr. Makele. Next up, I'd like to invite onto the stage Kat Francois, all the way from the UK, but descended from other interesting places.
Thank you. Good evening. Sayo bono. Thank you. That's all you will be getting. I only came in yesterday and that's all I've had time to learn. Hopefully by the end of the week there may be a few more words. I want to say thank you first of all for having me here this evening. It's an absolute pleasure. First time back home to Africa. I came out of the plane and I walked through the tunnel and there was about 15 black people just lining up, ready to clean. I was like, hello, black people. Also, there's so many beautiful sisters, girls, you lot, I'm telling you, I know some brothers in the UK, yeah? All right. If you are looking for man, all right, I know some brothers, you lot, woo! You lot would kill them. So this first piece I'm going to do is dedicated to all the beautiful sisters, because we don't get bigged up enough, so I'm bigging you up. And this piece is called Badam, and it's about the way that sisters walk. Yeah, you know. Badam, badam, badam. You know what I'm talking about, innit? Exactly. Badam. Badam, 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 badam. Thick arms, blessed with the kind of strength needed to carry heavy shopping and crying children, sweep and sway. Talawa, meaning strong legs, stride sturdy and strong. Many a male and female eye have appreciated the natural curve of her plump and inviting mango curve. She possesses a palm tree, swinging her hips, gyrating to grooves which tickle her toes, causing her womb muscles to twitch. Mounds of substance and joy fill a red chiffon dress, but magically it holds. She twirls and her skirt whips across her body, creating a crimson whirlwind of wonder. She furiously ball changes in 4-inch doomy heels. Badam, badam, badam. Unconcerned with the stubby ants which stick out of her rays of ravished skin, she raises her palms to the heavens and she gives thanks to the goddesses. And her rear has a rhythm of its own. Magical mountains of mouth-watering movement manipulatively undulate, even as the rest of her stays silent. Badam, badam, badam. She has a tooth missing. Her hair is not as long or as silky as they say it should be. Neither are her eyes as bright or her skin as light. But for now, she does not give a damn. And sycophants stand back, lizard, praying. Desperate to lick off the brown dew it seeps from her brown, brown skin. Now tomorrow she may wake up, look in the mirror and recoil at what stands before her. Tomorrow she may wake up, look at the society, and it may recoil from what it stands before them. But for now, she does not give a damn. And she is bucking and frosting with the word abandonment of a woman who is sick and tired of hating herself. Thank you. Thank you. This piece is just about my love for words. Words have blessed me, sanctified and caressed me, succeeded in berating and undressing me, forced me to see red and caused me to swear blue, raised me, roughed me up and shamed me. From me they stole, while making love to my dying soul. Made me weak when I aimed to be bold. Gave me strength when I thought none was left. Demanded I listened when I wished to be deaf. You see, through poetry I've learnt to fly, climb mountains and dare to dream. But I too have been tempted by sweet sounds, tumbling from handsome mouths, elaborating the truth. I too have been fooled by the beauty and enthusiasm of youth. You see, I've been slapped into reality by uncalled for profanity, brought to my knees by lyrics that have stunned me. But as I stand here before you, peeling off layers of my delicate skin, I reveal to you the person within. I may come across as confident and competent, articulate and intricate, but I too am riddled with self-doubt. And there are times when my pen won't flow. And words I've yet to learn, refuse to stay in my mind. But instead of reaching out in self-destruction, you know what, I reach for the pen. Instead of asking why, I demand when. Instead of hiding underneath comforting sheets, I face my demons until I feel complete. I've been known to release a stream of vicious consciousness that threatened to drown me. Then hold on for their life as a safety net of words comes to my rescue and teaches me how to breathe, cry, laugh, and make love again. Because words have blessed me, sanctified and caressed me, succeeding in berating and undressing me, forced me to see red, caused me to swear blue.
Africa is home to creativity. Fuck that poverty bullshit. Creativity oozes out of our pores because we are antiques scattered by the highest of hands. Hence, when we are brought onto this world, our elders celebrate and ululate because they know we carry gifts from the other side, so they look into our palms. It tells of our past, our present, and future encrypted in our lines. Our tongues carry rhythm, unique, unlike any other. Listen to us when we speak, the clicks. No man can steal or imitate these treasures found in our tongues. We told of stories before stories, captured memories in melodies before pens and pages. We recorded our existence in rocks, kept our history files on our minds, sang our legacies from generation to generation, reciting our accomplishments through poetry and song. And sometimes when words seemed not to be enough, we used our bodies to tell of our tales. We danced till intertwined aligned with the wind, awakening spirits with the tapping of our feet. We used nature as a shield, understood that God spoke to us through art, understood that God is art. So mnandine bongo ne ndiyazidla nge Africa, because we work on gold, platinum and coal, and that's not all. We have flowing rivers of minerals and oils, host more than 40% of the world's resources, and still that not all. We are gods in creativity. So how dare they associate us with poverty? But how dare you associate yourselves with poverty? Next time they ask you about Africa, tell them Africa is a continent of divinity. Here people have healing powers on their palms. We are able to weave scattered souls back to life, heaven on earth. We are a divine entity. Africa is home to creativity. Fuck that poverty bullshit. So you and all of you who are Africans are damn divine. Who you should know nothing of Africa. You should know nothing of poverty. I don't know how much time I have left, but you must come back on Thursday. You must come back on Thursday, hey? So yeah, women, you are beautiful. Be it you are rocking heels, gladiators, or sneakers, with your braids, dreadlocks, or a chiskop. Kayalami, you are a descendant of she warriors, African women who wore the African bodies with ease, sun-kissed beauties who wore their tones as if it was the purest form of gold. Even when you are crucified by isms, bodies splashed on billboards prescribing to you, women of beauty, what a woman of beauty should be, even when fallen sons masculate themselves on your insecurities. Woman, do not be victim, because you are beautiful in your skin tone, shape, and size. Carry your body and gender with pride. Walk tall. Be oblivious to all the tags and insults thrown at you for being secure and free under your own skin. Strut your stuff even more. Carry your lineage on your shoulders, wisdom on your tongue, nations on your womb. Carry woman, proud woman. You are beautiful every day, even in your ugly days, with your mistakes. Now make them lessons cleaner when the world turns its back on your screams. Crucified for defining your own ideologies, choosing your own lovers and own orgasms. Cleaner when the same sons who have lived off your back, molded by your hands, now put their sons to scribble ugly on your skin, tattooing the father's mistakes, drunken slurs on your skin. Woman, do not be victims, because you are beautiful. Every day, kayalami marajonga bakwenza ntoni. You are screaming bitch, slut, whore. Your tongues are sharpened against each other. You are breaking the bond of woman and sisterhood. No, there is no doubt in your gender. Carry your gender proud and dress all these demons deemed to exist under your skin. Nude, find self-love. Give yourself a hug. Welcome what and who you are with open arms, because women, you are beautiful every day.
Agwande Gogo. So, those of you who came to Poetry Africa last year would have seen Kanye and two other poets on our stages as one of the prelude poets of the festival. This year, from tomorrow until Friday on the stage, we're gonna have another four Durban poets that we'll be introducing to you as an audience. Abalobi tomorrow, which is the duo of Nhlanhla Begwa and Shiwe Mthwazi. On Wednesday, it's Hlengiwe Mbatha. On Thursday, it's Sibonisile Ngubane. And lastly, on Friday, it's Rodney Ruskruger. So this is a testament of how Poetry Africa is developing young voices and sharing them with you as an audience. Next up, I'd like to call Gwazi Langisa, a poet from Durban.
Sanibonani. Yes. Yo, these guys are so awesome. Yeah.
Eziposweni ndifunde, ezingozini ndisinde, ndizawuhamba amazwe, xa ubetha izandla ndisine, xa kubetha intsimbi yesine, ndizawuhamba amazwe. Maluni pokwe ndikelele, teta nezinyanyu zikelele, ndiza wamba maze mama, ndikulele, tata na mabalu ndifundele, ndiza wamba mazwe ngama. Iziki zentliziyo kamama imlolozelo yamihla namalanga ngezinyanga zobumnyama bosana. Namhla selwafika ezweni mama isifuba kuyoba ikhaya lemfudumalo. Sezingephi isikhumbuzo sezifunge engazenza zengikhululwe ebumnyameni. Imigqa ezandleni inani lamakhono engawafunjathiswa mhla ngisendleleni ebheke emhlabeni. Somandla ngicela ikhandlela ngihlahla indlela ebheke ekukhanyeni. Izwe lifa mihla namalanga kepha inyanga yazalwa ivunule ngamakhambi. Kangisoze ngayeka amazimba aqedwe izinkumbi. Mama ngicela ukufulathela ikhaya kangikuhlamuki ngiyohle ngi-Afrika. Ngiyohlomlisa abantu ngezithelo zesithombo wasifundisa ngenhlonipho nothando wasichelela ngolwazi. Hlezi kusasa lentsha liyoqhakaza njengonyezi. Imlolozelo kamama ingane ikhali ikhula ikhuleka kubaba iswele ingena baba ngivula iminyango ngena baba. Ngibuyisa ithemba belilala hleka bahleka kanti lilanda izimpendulo. Imlolozelo kamama ngivala amaphiko ngifukamela babonakala bengena amanxeba kanibophele ngaphakathi. Amathemba womphakathi emalibeni asaphenduka ingxenye yomhlabathi. Sebebaningi bebonakala botha umlotha amaphupha azalele emlilweni ashabalala. Kepha ngathembisa umama ukuthi ngamagama ngiyovusa abalele ngibuyisa babuqamama. Imlolozelo kamama ngihlabelela ingoma yabafazi abaqhwakela entabeni becela imvula. Izinkomo kazibuyanga emadlelweni lo mhlaba ugwadule. Ngiye ngakhumbula iziyalo engazibelethiswa mhla ikhaya lami ngilipha umhlane namhla usehlane. Ungalibali asikho isidumbu sethemba. Eziposweni ndifunde, ezingozini ndisinde, ndizawuhamba amazwe, malume pokwe ndikelele, teta nezinyanyu zikelele, ndizawuhamba amazwe mama. Ikulele, tata na mabalu ndifundele, ndizawuhamba amazwe ngamazwe.
Ndiyabonga.
Bengazi niyakikiza. It's like that. Thank you very much, Kwazi. Next up, I'd like to call on stage Lebo Mashile.
Everywhere you go, there are bones lining the bottom of the ocean floor. Twisted rope, rotting flesh, dead hope. Click, click, says the camera. You keep asking for more everywhere you go. Bones like a fabric, they tie you into knots. Not love, you can't have it. You wear them like a cloak. Bones, my belonging, you love the grip of fear. Not love, you can't have it. Burnt bones fill the eyes. Minds of the children, you serve them hell as life. Ignite flames in the stitches. Burnt bones on their knees, begging for forgiveness. Click, click, says the camera. This is survival. This is business. Bones queued up, single file, papers ready. Bones at the border. This is business. Money heavy. You love the taste of bullets. Minds of the children, you love the cut of borders like your own hands stitched them, you filthy little faggot. Bones snapping in the mouth, you crazy black bitch. You chew the bones. You spit them out. Bones between books. Books become laws. Bones fill these streets. You chew them up. You spit them out. Bones of twisted ropes pulling millions to the shore. Bones breaking over me, you chew them up, you spit them out, and you keep asking for more.
So like we're not even halfway through. That's what's up. Another Lebohang that I'd like to, Lebohang Nova Masango, we'd like to welcome you onto the Poetry Africa stage.
Thank you so much for having me. Okay, I don't know if I'm... Okay. Stand as tall as time. Because these skies bear witness to how mere dust can rise to meet God in the air. There lies your story, from grime to glory. Struggles turn scripture inscribed into your spine to remind your backbone of what you've always known. The ground is not your home. Straighten up and fly right, endure and keep on. You are the celebration. Never a funeral march or swan song, this 808 of your heartbeats only triumph from war. March on till life hands you an applause for the curse and the cause, for the fight and the flaw, for the sleepless nights of dreams that dance victory to your door. Keep resilience at your core and a church in your palms. You're the future that is fashioned from fight and freedom song. Stay low, keep firing, and it won't be too long if you endure. To-do list for Africa. When you no longer hate who you are and the circumstances that brought you here, undress yourself. Reclaim your weathered body without fear. Stand naked at your Nile and hold your reflection dear. Behold a brilliance. You, cracked riverbed, rainforest, desert, monsoon, savanna, swamp, almighty harmattan, spectacle of sand dunes, are the wonder of the earth. Cleanse yourself. Bathe in still waters, and while contemplating your future, flick the chip off your shoulder. Treat yourself to a makeover. Yeah. Dress in all your splendor, just like the days of old. Adorn yourself in the armor of oil, diamonds, and gold. Destroy the robe of martyr once and for all. Deprive the stain of colonialism any relevance or meaning. Pack your throat full of a narrative that truly believes in healing. Let it be your song. Sung through centuries, decades, eras, and echoed by possibility, echoed by possibility, echoed by possibility. See, the sun will forever speak highly of me. Take the sandstorm of my skin as testament to the survival of Timbuktu manuscripts and the creation of Egyptian architects. Our blood carries the staying power of ancients. How solar rays cast exact shadows was our version of 8:45. So fuck African timing. We exist in a time before time. The sun is our culture. Take this to-do list as lesson, and once again let love be our nature. Africa, I am begging with all of my brownness. Unlearn the word pirate when speaking of poor Somali people actively controlling the destiny of their seas against European greed. They are protectors. Unlearn the wrath of fire, the way hatred burns down shacks in Khayelitsha, beats down bodies in Diepsloot, and rapes in Alexandra, leaves the devastation of desperation in its wake, poor against poor, and nothing is being done by the state. Never forget Harambe. Unlearn your blemishes. Unlearn Idi Amin, Mobutu, Bashir, Mengistu. Unlearn civil wars, coups, blood diamonds, kleptocracy, xenophobia, genocide, child soldiers and casualties. Unlearn your ugly. Yeah. Africa, my love for you was a broken mirror. Sits heavy in the cavity of my chest, among dusty boxes full of Fela Kuti songs in a history bloodied by regret. Between these nervous conditions, things fall apart, yet still we rise unapologetic for our breath. Occupied with survival and sky, light is what we reflect through the pieces and pieces of turmoils, disasters, and diseases. A whole continent overlooked by the mercy of Jesus. I need us to love ourselves a whole lot louder, even when the first world can't see us. When it cuts to tell the truth, when the ignorance of our tongues licks salt into each other's wounds, when it hurts to heal, when the taste of freedom is not yet as familiar food as that of abuse. Africa, I promise to never throw your name around like an old excuse. I vow to reclaim all that honors the origin of we without fear. Bloodied, but never broken, we are still here. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nova. This marks 50 years of Papa Rams doing his thing out here in the world, and we really wanted to be a part of it. So we have Lesego Rampulukeng, Bavino Bachana, Papa Rams.
I even forgot I've got my spectacles here. You know what, paper is not very popular on this stage, you know, because my people are so beautiful, which is okay then, because I was going to, you know, toss some words at some people to say, poetry, how haina di potris. I cry for the trees dying for this, but it's not necessary now, anyway, I don't know what I want to do. I can't see anymore. Yeah, All right. Maybe I should do what? Huh? Superstars, asteroids, or steroids and hemorrhoids? All things I try to avoid. Now time has stuck a fist so far up my rectum, it's waving amandla out of my mouth. What a bloodless! What a bonus going to treat. No, but I think no. I don't want to do that. I don't want to do that. I just want to honor and cry for a dearly departed brother of mine who was a mic rocker, a brilliant lyricist. He never published a book, so he never caused a single tree to die in vain. He never did. What he did do was release audio recordings and rock countless mics. And people would walk up to this man whom I loved, who could outwrite any of them and outrhyme any of them, and they say to him, Robo, you know, I love this hobo look you're rocking. He wasn't rocking a hobo look. He couldn't afford to buy fancy clothes. Now, Robo died poverty-stricken, just like Mafika Koala did, just like Ingwa Pele Maringwani did, just like how I'm probably going to go out. I don't know. But I want to do this slowly because I've been accused of, you know, rapping too fast, speaking too fast, when actually I've always believed. It's not that I speak too fast. It's just like people listen too slowly. And like Brother Jeff said, if you feel that I'm going over your head, jump. Don't expect me to squat. All right. Okay. Notes for Robotech. I hope I can squeeze this into 4.5 minutes. If I don't, just, you know, jump around a little bit, I'll notice. Notes for Robotech. Word God. Robotic Armageddon lyricist. Profundities geneticist. Cold school lyrical scrolls unfold in layers players can't manifest. Mental uranium to intellectual atom bomb from underground innards. Break surface toxin awards, toxin rewards. Murder by hunger and homicidal starvation. Show me whores, I'll show you swine, little misogynist. Go swing off a pole by your vast deference. Twist the thread of the robo book of rhymes aligned, sacred against the hatred materially created. No inspiration lines, but intestines stretched out. Scratch my spinal cord is a vinyl record. One stanza eat away is a cancer. Empty stomach heave. Empty stomach heavy ruckus, dready focus. Stake my neck on a train of thought wreck lyric. And flip it rough. That pop stuff. Go on the plant's floor. Got a nightmare for a metaphor. Muddy rhymes on bloody rhythms. Oh Lord, have mercy. Rock god of the die, versified. While poison pulp pulses in Joburg veins, style it thus. That poverty kills is no genius. And pervert the Jamaica thing. Mimic and live, create, and the artist dead. And that's the shebang bang, like when the uninformed, like when the uniformed R1, R4 rang Sharpeville, Soweto, Cebu came. We pauseless rap through the pause, no metaphor. That's great white jaws and vampire laws. Shark progress, blood suck commerce, draining life juice of freedom verse. Slime time, universal, unique God verse self. Anon spawn, Satan horn, God vessel. Capital mill, mediocrity rules for fuck. Weird technician, no condiment, but apocalyptic vision embodiment of robot tech wars against prognostic whores, sprouting mainstream purulent soft flows. What keep the fed in fed? South African version? They wrap it in gore. Skin of my brother, comrade, friend. Mourning the microphone, God passing through. Bow down, man's the truth. The stamp is deep ink, imprint stays on, legacy shine. Rest easy, lyrical angel, weird warrior, soldier, poet. Easy Robotech, rapping it from heaven's roof. Fuck serpent award ceremonies of filth. I get more love where the count is lyrical riches beyond material wretches. From here to wherever this thing called life stretches. No coffin, casket, tomb talk, antiquity. You're rhyming the womb from here to eternity. That's a true line of poetry. Rap running past 2-1 crap lies, lined in paradise. And that art, this reality, the core you died for, opposite the gravel floor. Versus aligned, versus corporate, prostituted, executive perspective, sick, life, finance, freakonomics in the mix, constitutes the retrogressive. Posterity is the genesis, the end, where it begin. No one-line critic lyric, pioneer spirit. We will yet see Mahlatini growl turned, minimize Coca-Cola, tinius, Minnie Mouse howl at devil's end. Lyric spit, AK spray, oceanic pen play. Fuck, who's the televised back? Keeps the fuck who's the televised best. I bring that back again. Fuck who's the televised best. Keeps the fee. Still no free lip. Can they pay the sea? Still no free lip. Can they pay the sea? Robotech, poem, storm, bomb, best, blast effects, last beyond Hiroshima genetics. Itching for Cullinan and diamond shine and Joburg fame buried beneath mine dumps. Shaking soul thief, gold rift, ramped, sand-locked, rectum itching for a Rustenburg platinum butt plug. Fantasize up the aliment with a treacherous bone, precious stone, and crusted lock. Toilet, bankroll cells, all exotic for tourist bog titillation, self-dehumanization. Rust content rhyme on a dust context rhythm. Crepper rappers got a bland crew rag joint. Dumbed down to rap and fetching clown. Pissy blather whack.
They made the move from art of war to fat of gore when intellect assault put mental to asphalt. But easy, Father Tech, you got it slain on point, pointing pain towards self-dignification. Respect.
Respect, Papa Rams. Staying with the respect, it is quite an honor to welcome Makosa Zanaklava back to the Poetry Africa stage.
Sanbonani. Ninjani. Hi, nami ngiyaphila bandla. I'm going to read two short poems that I wrote when I'd been asked to be at a launch of the National Library Week, AISA Cape Town in Johannesburg. And I had never been asked to write for an event. So by Friday night, I was actually feeling desperate because I hadn't written anything. The event was the following day. So I called a friend of mine, who's also a poet. I thought, you know, she could help. So I said, friend, I have a problem, and I have a bit of a solution. I'd like to hear your feedback on my solution. She said, what's your problem? I said, I agreed to go to this, but I don't have a poem. And she said, what's your solution? I said, I'm going to have diarrhea, and I won't show up. She said, what's the event again? I said, it's the launch of the National Library Week. She said, but friend, you love books. What's your story? Just write. Just write. And I thought, oh, okay, then I'll write. So I wrote two poems. The first one is called To My Librarian. Bones. Gifts under the tongue. Mampela Rampela. Call me woman, Mhudi, woman at point zero. No sweetness here. Seeing voices, hearing visions, nervous conditions, things fall apart and they didn't die. The shadow of Imana, the black insider, the famished road, the wrath of the ancestors, the quiet violence of dreams, the screaming of the innocent. Weep not, child. Love, child, these things happen. When rain clouds gather, head above water, desperate, never been at home, Muriel at the Metropolitan, juggling truths, living, loving, and lying awake at night, a life's mosaic. So long a letter, I write what I like, blame me on history. Petals of blood, flames of fury, soul fire. Gods of our time, the emperor, underground people, it all begins differently each time. Drawn in color on covers, titles, authors' names, publishers, ISBN numbers, my librarian knows it all. I watch her smile, I wish I could read her mind. Her voice never high, her searches always have results. If not what I wanted, an even better suggestion. Umenjalo, my librarian, oh, if I could sing. Bones, gifts under the tongue, Mampela Rampela. Call me woman, Mhudi, woman at point zero. It all begins differently each time. My librarian opened doors to books I have known and books I have loved, to worlds I never knew and worlds I wish I knew. At each encounter, these hands receive and say, my librarian, this way I salute you in our lifetime. So the second poem I wrote that book that night is called My Book. My book has never been too tired to go to bed with me. It never has a headache or needs downtime to discuss the day. It never says, please, not now, I'm not in the mood. In fact, my book seduces me with its spine that beckons from the shelf, yearning for my touch. When I reach out to hold it between my fingers, it eases into them, slides into my palm, yields to my gaze. With tenderness, it lays its pages bare for me and speaks words that carry me through waves of emotions. When my eyes won't open and I am spent, it rests right next to me, ready for the next round.
Oh no, Sis Makhosana, I'm just not sure about this. I could just talk about you while you plug it in. You wanna do that? Okay, so Matt, it's actually Matt Wilson, but he was once with a band called the Car Boot Vendors, and everybody got to know him as Matt the Vendor. So when he decided to do his solo thing in life, he became Matt Vend. I think most of you, if you're from Durban, you know Matt. He's bringing a guitar and a harp in order to accompany his... Are you good? All right, are you going to walk in with it? What do I do? Okay, cool. Matt Vender, everybody.
Hello. I'd just like to thank Tani for having me, and Mitch, and all the other poets. It's a real honor to be here. If this thing works. Sorry, I'm just tuning. I could go back to the old days, old songs, sing along. But I can't go back, 'cause I'm moving forward. I'm taking anything I can from the past into the future. Taking something bold, something new, something beautiful from a certain lighting in this room. A throat on a crouton from spilled soup. Hopefully I'll turn this all into something new. You guys having a good time tonight? Welcome to Poetry Africa. A leaf book, scattered clothes, a plastic coat, hanger, all words with prose, a random thoughts of friends who act as foes, counting fingers and toes, solitary trickery, a calamity, standing alone, oh what a tragedy, he confiding in Father Time, relying on Mother Nature to Mother Rhyme, I'm figuring that everything is nothing and nothing is everything to me, oh wait, I'm in simplicity, let us be and I'll let you be, I'll let you be. Cause I'm figuring that everything is nothing and nothing is everything to me. Oh, and I meant simplicity. I'm trying to recite a poem because I've actually got another minute. Try to get out of my head languages I can't master. Try to keep the mind fed, activation deviate from disaster. My mind starts to wander through pages, bricks and plaster, concepts that I just can't foster. First world problems in the third world. I think of every city street, but I can't remember. I think of signs and symbols, landmarks, trademarks, track marks, skid marks. These skidding tires and winter's nights, I smell smoke. And where there's smoke, there's fire. Stomach full and bed warm, but out there it's cold and frightening. I'd never want to land up in a place like this. I'd never want to land up in a hell like this. Thank you, guys. I'm Matt. See you next time.
The next poet I'm going to call up, we tried to adopt her, we did, right? And then somehow things just went pear-shaped. Now she's living in Cape Town. We're so happy to have you at Poetry Africa, Bali Vilakazi.
In the quiet of the uncertainty of the moment just before, short of breath and unlearning, we awaken and unearth ourselves. Something of who we might have been is found. Everything about who we could be remains. We must always, always remember that we have survived. Making our way from the other, as the liminal, ill-fitting, and unacceptable puzzle pieces that we are, our lives flower into scripts, emerging from lips, stoic, and finally responding, and from non-being, we become the known, visible again. From our positions of onward and gazing towards the unseen, no different, no better, and certainly no less, only that we chose. As we continue to keep choosing life and the living, only to try and try yet once more, we have stood as questions. Unfamiliar on street corners, in smoke-filled rooms, choking on intimate conversations devoid of any compassion, entire lives packed hastily into unlabeled boxes, wondering, where to from here? And we have been questioned, who are you? What right do you have? What makes you so special? Who do you think you are? Who are your parents? What do they do? What do you do? Who do you know? Who knows you? What benefit will I gain from you? How much money do you make? What cell phone do you have? Where did you live? Where do you go to school? What car do you drive under the winding detours of circumstance enforced upon us? It had us peering from below the jump. Over the edge and swung like pendulum, split down, forgotten and careful now, although we have not always been unsure. Upended bridges made of steel and dry ice and sinew, just holding it together, hold it together, hold it together, it's what we do. Locked inside ourselves, always shackled to some other person, some other memory, some other crime. The parent who wasn't there, the friends you thought you had, and how you would discover that they didn't care. Too fat or too black, or whether it was because you were a woman, a lesbian, or uncool and poor, it was always something, wasn't it? Wasn't it? Wasn't it? They said you weren't enough and unworthy. Unworthy of their protection, unworthy of their love. Be someone else. Be something else. Be anything. Just don't be you. It was not so much what they said. It was what they did. The justice that didn't include you, it was what they didn't do. But we are still here. So it can be done. Ordinary people, there is solace in this, and it is of significance. These days, even the clouds doing what they always do means something. We are many who dream the other dream. Tears continuously greening my heart, a smile stuck in my throat, eyes distant with palms, but I will not turn. It is an everyday of who we are, and if all one has is the search, then it is that, the unavoidable sailing, the surrender to being misunderstood. Stretched against the backdrop of disappointment, gray plumaged and singed, make like life itself, colorful and unapologetic, and keep looking. Some things are worth fighting for. Die to yourself. In the midst of flames, you are the phoenix. With its great beauty and deathless inspiration, a gentle creature. Alighting so softly, crushing nothing, eating dewdrops. The soul of Ra, the sun, the soul of Ra, the sun, the one who always dies, the one who never dies.
Thank you, Mbali. You're going to have to disconnect yourself from that hug. Mthunzika Zimbungwana from the Eastern Cape via Johannesburg.
Molweni ngaphakathi. Inkosi. Wawuthembisile is the title of this poem. This poem is told through the voice of a child who was left behind when his father moved to the cities in search of better opportunities. And when he got there, he started new families and leaving behind that child. So that's the voice. Wawuthembisile wathi uza kubuya. Yaqengqeleka iminyaka, abanye batyibilika, abanye babambelela wenyawe negama lakho. Unyana wakho uThemba wayekutshona eKapa eyokukhangelana nawe naye zange abuye. Undiva uthi waphelela etilongweni ePaulsmoor ebanjelwa izenzo zenkohlakalo nentiyo. Umafungwashe wakho unomabala ugcwele idolophu phaka uKomani uvuke ekuseni okuqokelela amakhoba otywala ukuze alale enxilile yonke le mihla zimthembende zona inzingo. Unomalizo yena wayekutshona eGoli wafika eGoli wazitshintsha igama wazibiza uLizi. Wacula eziklabhini esonwabisa amadoda ashiye ngasemva abafazi abantwana nesithukuthezi. Waphume ngena ezibhedini zala madoda egqoqagqoqana nothando ongazange umnike lona wena njengomzali. Wagula wanqina waba ngumcingi uba ngabe usaphila ngoku sambonga uThixo kunye nezinyanya. Mna ke noba ndingazichaza ngeke undazi ngoba mna wandishiya ndisesesizalweni sikamama. Umama lo ke naye wabhubhayo samngcwabo ezantsi kwegato okugqirha bayikhumsha bathi yidepression ndithi mna yindlala ngumvandedwa nokuphelelwa lithemba. Ufikile ke ngoku wena ndoda ndindi sowungathethi ufake kwibhokisana emnyama kuthiwa mna mandikungcwabe ndagqiba ndikhaphe ngenkomo. Iza kuvela phi inkomo wena xa wemkaphe ekhaya ushiya zingasekho. Ndixolele mntakwethu ndiza kubeka phaa phandle ube lilifa lezinja neempethu.
Please, please be sure to catch Mthunzi Kanzi on Saturday for a workshop entitled Finding Your Voice. Next up, I'd like to call Mutlemo Tiba from Joburg to the stage.
Hello, everybody. I would like to dedicate this poem to anybody who's got a dream, who's chasing a dream, who finds chasing after that dream kind of hard sometimes. Us standing here has been quite a test, and we're still here. So. The funniest thing to fallen Martians is that coal and diamonds are actually distant cousins separated by time. Blood lines our tables like cocaine sniffed by perception to elevate your conscious highness from the unconscious peasant. We use telescopes to shorten the distance between visual interpretation and the surface of the furthest of planets, but I say these things because I am an artist, right? I mean, for lack of better gestures, I use words. I trade silver tongues for air pockets, but my income only allows me to journey the distance from hand to mouth. Month in and month out, my mental odometer clocks the centimeters traveled. The stomach notes the small harvest while the muscles fall apart. But the publishers keep calling me though, leaving voice messages like, hey, don't let thoughts tamper with your inner workings. We need to collect your spirit and dust it for print. We want readers feeling like they are reading too much into your work. The critics should note you as one who has the demeanor of a prince, even when he's wearing the clothes of a servant. And when on stage, the spiritual wind should sense the head of a lion, the body of a goat, and the tail of a serpent. This art form allowed me to appear different. I mostly stand like the accused in a lineup, but my face changes every time the viewer blinks. I am the modern-day author of magical books where the cover remains the same, but the content keeps changing, adapting to the reader's feelings. Yesterday, she loved the body movements, just didn't really note the content. Today he digs the cursive approach, loving how it's hard to distinguish where my words end and my soul begins. Tomorrow, you'll be questioning how deep my spirit really runs. When I finally confess that the pedestal you've put me on is bad for my lungs, the air up here is too thin. Thick and tough skin is pointless when one is constantly running out of breath. But the flying termites keep sending word though, reminding me that footprints are hard to note when wings are the mode of transportation. And I've noted that my art has a loyal following while I struggle to keep up with myself. I mean, I'm fighting more and listening less, I'm writing less and feeling more. The bags under my eyes feel heavier by the day, but the needle on my scale keeps receding. My mother questions the sky I fell from while my son worships the ground I walk on. I've misplaced the coordinates to my woman's heart and my dreams are war-torn, but I'm an artist, right? I mean, for lack of better gestures, I keep using these words. Look, you can keep the glowworms. I have a chest full of words to capture everything from sadness, madness, isolation, and love. The tip of a crescent moon might be the loneliest place in the universe, but it is the best place to fish for falling dreamworks. And man, I keep fishing. I keep fishing. I keep fishing, hoping to reel in lighter versions of me. Forget gauntlets. Being an artist can sometimes be one of the hardest obstacles on this side of the universe.
Next up, I'd like to call Ghanaian author and poet via the UK, Nee Parkers.
I'm a very serious man. Can I share a true story with you? You know how there are lots of people in this world judged by the 3 hours they spend making love in a day? Well, Coming here was an interesting thing because I realized you're also judged by the passport you hold. Being a proud African man, I went to the agents that South Africa uses to process their visas with my Ghanaian passport. And they told me I would need to have £600 in my current account and bring 4 months of statements and all this kind of jazz, right? And I mean, for me, you don't keep that kind of money in your current account anyway. That means you're not living, right? Or it should be in your savings account, or you should invest in somebody's dream or something, you know? Anyway, so I didn't go back. They gave me a letter to come back. And then I came here with my UK passport, and they just waved me in. And I'm thinking, right, a black man living in Ghana, you won't allow to come in. A black man living in the cold of England, you let him walk into South Africa? You think he's going to go back? Let's work with the logic, man, okay? Embrace the Africans. Because the last time you let the English here, they didn't treat you so nicely. Okay. So, really short poem. It's a haiku. It takes a while, so I call it a slow burner, but it's a warning. And it goes like this. If you know you can't deal with my pregnant mood swings, don't fuck with my pain. And this next poem is a poem about how, in trying to protect our children, sometimes we stop them from experiencing the very things that made us. It's called Men Like Me. I wrote this for my mother. My mother warned me about men like me. Laid back, crazy, locked men like me. Mother said, be careful of men like me. Dark, tattooed, and locked men like me. But my father was a man like me. So it seems, my mother liked men like me. My mother warned me about laid-back men like me. Men with lazy leans and sharp eyes who love nothing better than an evening on a street corner tasting the world slice by sour slice. Men with rough beards and dreadlocks whose hands settle easily into pockets. Men with 1,000 ways to pause and paint plain days in shades of ore and blue, who dream in many dialects, smell of spice, men whose tongues... slide easily over lips. My mother told me to steer clear of wise-cracking men like me, sun-hardened, hard-working, smooth-talking, with deep laughs and tattoos, usurping God's calling as creator, rewriting their own skins. My mother warned me about men like me, laid-back, crazy, locked men like me. Mother said, be careful of men like me, dark, tattooed, and locked men like me. But my father was a man like me. So it seems.
Ladies, take his mother's advice, eh? Next up, I'd like to call Nogulunga Dlala onto the stage. You are there, okay.
Sanbonani. Gamalam ngu Nogulunga Dlala. Ngiyimbongi.
Right, hello everyone. Nice to see you today. I was so looking forward to see everybody tonight. I'm an African child. Well, they know me as a black child. Because I'm a black child. I'm a black child. I'm a black child. The beautiful, the powerful, the colorful, rich with identity, deep with dignity, the strong, the brave, the courageous, the proud. Race has nothing to do with it, but freedom of expression from within that allows this black child to be free. I said a black child, an African child. That's me, right? Now, what is the next line? Line's gone, but still, the African blood that runs in your veins, it runs in mine. Right? So ngium Africa ngesiqi, ngium Africa ngemvunge, empeleni ngi Africa uqobo lwayo. Ndiri munhu mutima, ndakanaka ndinesimba. It's one spirit, one blood, one Africa. So what could separate one skin from skin, one blood from blood? Namingcele nalimilungelo ahlukanisa ibala nebala igazi negazi. Yeah, well, those are just lines that just wrote down after this whole xenophobic thing in Durban. It just made me sick. But then, I'm a person who writes about women. So that's what I'm going to do right now. I'm sure I'm still left with a minute or so. Two, exactly. With those poems and poetry, I intend telling the stories untold. Not just fables of old women, but to reveal the consoled truth about the reality, the suffering, the pain this woman endures day by day. This woman has lost her worth. Her womanness has been degraded. Her soul is controlled by the blowing of the winds. She has suffered persecution by the scums of this land. She has lost hope of rising from the dust. She can play marimba no more. She can smile no more. She can dance no more. She can cry no more. Izinyembezi sezomile, hayi ngoba sekungcono, but she is dehydrated, for she cried and cried and she cried and cried and she cried until she could cry no more. Nalendo dayigqigqizelela usuku nosuka imgqizi qakala. Iyamgqilaza nomeqhuzuka imgqugquzeli akasakwazi ngisho ukuchopha ingqakala lo mthwalo yamesindu yabona nalendoda imsisi ayimshayi ndiva. Poets of this generation, thathani peni nosiba and write, write so her name will be remembered for generations to come. Njengeqhawe elinamandla, iqhawe elingahlehla elingadubi elingadangala elingadikibali, holding on so her kids could have a brighter future. Eisha indivi ntlungu kuza fihle ihlazo lomyeni wakhe ogijima kuze kuse nabesimama abazidelile. Poets of this generation, thathani iphepha nosiba and write, write so her name will be remembered for generations to come. Write for her self-esteem, please write, write for her dignity. Assure her that she's beautiful. Assure her that she's loved. Assure her that she's appreciated. Assure her that she's complete. Assure her that she's worth it. For this woman has, for this woman has, for this woman has lost her worth.
Next up, I'd like to call Nosipho Magcaba, another Durban-based poet, to the stage. There you go.
She walks into the club and a bum greets you 5 minutes later. So seductive, luscious, having every man trying to mack her. Having him wish that life was like a blackberry and they scream muncher in order to munch her. Her name is Nosipho Magcaba. How are you guys doing? A heathen dressed in black, Bible in hand, is a disturbing factor. A goof of Hitler, bystander bending backwards only to realize that nothing really matters. Gray matter is a major component of the nervous system consisting of neon cell bodies. Everybody has it in their brainstem and cerebral, so you see, brah. I don't really understand why he did what he did, because I know he got a brain. I karate chop his skull open, hoping to get some answers, but he keeps flipping the scripts like dyslexic actors. His lies malignantly grow into tumors of cancer. He said he loved me, but I guess not in that manner. At least, not until the day that he looked at my sister. Insomniac night sweats of guilty pleasures, he tiptoed into my sister's room, locked her lips, and he raped her. Clerical call around the throat the next morning, that is just the cover. That's right, everybody. My husband, the preacher, strutting like a bloody savior while I envision a shredder slowly slicing his sexual dagger, slice it right down to his bladder, and blood splatters as I dig him a grave using nothing but fingers and with the rigor of hatred, and seeing my blooded sister, I aim at that nigger. And I pull the trigger. I do this in my head instead of cunning sheep trying to sleep, but the Sandman is proving to be elusive. You know you're stupid, because you could have had her. She was far from a saint, more like a blissful sinner, a non-believer. 50 rands, just 50 rands, was all it took for her to wrap her soft lips around your manly pleasure, W-H-O-R-E. That's how you spelt her. You could have had her. All you had to do was pay her. But let's not dwell on the past, because that's a painful chapter. Instead, get down on our knees and say a prayer. Because when Jesus appears, angels gather. If the practitioner is praying to a God which is all-knowing, it would be presumptuous for him to believe they understand the grand scheme of things sufficiently to pray for what is best. So I pray for myself, my sister, and even God's rejects. I'm sorry if I'm being disrespectful, Father, but the qualities I see lived out so well in some people are just a reflection of your own goodness. So I know it wasn't your traits that made him do this. His actions need no justifications, nor excuses. The only way we can get through this is if you open our eyes as you did the blind man so that we can really see. Tune our ears as you did the deaf man so we can hear what you were saying to us. May the experiences of our surroundings remind us to be aware of everything that is around us, and may all that we do bring us closer to you. Be, Lord Jesus, a bright flame before me, a guiding star above me, and a smooth path below me, a kindly shepherd behind me. Today, tonight, and forever, slender of light eternal, shining within the glory of the rainbow, come and waken him from the grayness of his apathy and renew in him your gift of hope. Give him your wisdom to teach, your hand to guide, and may your word give him speech. But most of all, reach. Reach deep, deep down within. Accept my sister. And forgive him. Thank you.
Next up, I'd like to invite Ntiki Mazwai to join the poets presenting themselves to Poetry Africa.
Molweni KwaZulu. Inzala zikaNandi. Ndingumamiya Cwanini usibewu sala kulandelo ndazalwa ngumfazi obelede wanyisela ngaphesha komlanjani ugcaka ugqokasha Now that the mighty have fallen, who's going to watch over us, preach over us, take over us? These statues represent those who stole from us. They represent an apartheid history. My own story remains a mystery, a confusory forgery, for I have been labeled a born free. My freedom is a dorm freeze. Andilazi ibalilam kotwa nifuna ndilazi elabo. Now that the mighty have fallen, now that the mighty have fallen. The African child is victorious. Now the apartheid generation is getting nervous. They fear us. Bayasaba. They need the buses' permission. Now the breakdown in communication. The beautiful ones are born and we need an explanation. It's an abomination to idolize those who are part of your dehumanization. It is an abomination to idolize those who are part of your dehumanization. Whose history are we celebrating, commemorating? Which legacies are our future generations celebrating? Or does it not matter? And why are we so self-erasing? Now that the mighty have fallen. I'll see you on Thursday night. I'm performing with Mabu Matala Kunene. Thank you so much for everything.
Thank you, Mamiya. Next up, I'd like to call Thabiso Afurakan Muhare from Joburg.
Dumela? I hear people are leaving, so I'll make it quick. So I'm selling books. I've got Lebo Mashile's Flying Above the Sky, Mekosi Klaba, award-winning, recognized. And then I have MedVend as well. So, like, I'll be standing outside just in front of Adam's bookstore. Just in front. buy it from a poet. No commission. I work with young people. Freedom of expression. Everyone has the right to freedom of expression, which includes A, freedom of the press and other media. B, freedom to receive or impart ideas. C, freedom of artistic creativity. And D, academic freedom and freedom of scientific research. 16.2, we say, 21 poem salute for all the writers who die on stage thinking their egos are word proof. Your technique is not unique. Your Facebook status is not a poem. Your Jesu. Your BlackBerry tweet is not a haiku. Your Facebook status is not a poem, and your blog is not a novel. Yes, nothing epic. You need to read more. Let wisdom unveil your ignorance. Maybe you can see more and be more informed before you throw a careless speech at a time where men and women die for the words they speak. Salute. Arian stole my show, right? I was gonna do the silent poem, but white men are still doing it, stealing from us. So it's fine. So you can catch me cruising Joburg streets with a bag full of dreams. And this bag has not only built my backbone, but has at times been a home. I, the backpacker, navigate the city with the hustle man swagger. My shoes know the road, the feet just follow, stomach is hollow. May I borrow a moment of your life? I sell words for a living, rearranged into patterns. Patterns for meaning, and meanings bring a question. And questions are the blueprint and foundation for progress. And progression is the purpose of every single human being. And so if this body is flesh and the spirit is immortal, then I must be forever, and this life is just the portal. A super slick city sayon, words are my crayons. Never conform a nomad, I reform to transform. But this great city's a maze, many are slaves to the pace. So I pledge a line for minds caught in a daze. The streets house many, yet the walls are home to none. This is for that woman who's been searching for her son, who got seduced by the city blues, tangled with the naked muse, drunk from a horn of fools, a snack for these concrete wolves. And so tonight I saw my worlds again, plow fields of my imagination and harvest for all, even the lazy grasshopper. Because your ears are the master when it's words that feed a poet. A hungry stomach scars the body, but a starving mind murders the spirit. That's why we write and speak it for all universe to hear it. Because this poem and all poems are prayers, thought channeled back to the mothership, begging her to bring us home. But in the meantime, in this beautiful torture of steel, water, concrete heart, she calls her heart, Etegwini, I am home, an uncontrolled substance. Thank you. Can we please acknowledge a moment of black excellence? Hashtag black excellence, Tiny Mungwe. Salute, 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 salute.
Thank you, Afurakan, but you can't put Cedric out of business, yo. Next up, I'd like to call Tando Fuze, Durban-based poet, to come on stage.
Sanbonani Ninjani Pila Nam. A ton of us also clipped our wings for some foolish reasons. We were caught attempting to fly wingless. Ignorance, taking over our minds silently, butterflies, are as beautiful as teething wisdom. The nature of truth is it always resurfaces at the sight of light into our kingdoms, leaving folly hung at the edge of our sharpened tongues. We forget about our five senses and get stuck in the center of fear and disbelief, chaining our train of thoughts onto the high school desks we left behind, bars of conformity. And I still dream of eternity, perhaps as a Sunday dish served on lazy afternoons, resting my bones on the bosoms of nature's grandchild, a seedling of misbehaving apple trees. And yeah, I miss my grandmother sometimes. When at times she would carve smiles onto my eyes. She was a comforting gray cloud that never rained, but she bore silver linings where her teeth used to be. Pretty, I'm sure she still believes we haven't touched our wings and whispers, nurture your halo in my mother's ear before she makes me a morning cup of coffee, because sometimes we can't cope, only reminded by our lovers breathing heaven on our necks, dreary, wearing beaded branded tees, but we never worry about how our manners are dressed. Yes, you'll find others addressing us in loose belts of arrogance, others in high heels of misdirection, relying on People magazine for an ounce of self-worth, but our true worth's not on these bloody carry bags. We miss our wings. I believe I can fly, tattooed on our chests, superheroes suffocating inside us. I still remember the dreams that left me breathless, free falling from the rooftop of hope, growth grabbing me by the throat, and a little voice saying, find your purpose in these trying times, and you might find your wings on the rough edges of your callousness.
Thank you, Tando. Next up, another Durban-based poet named Tsebeletso Muhale.
Good evening, everybody. How y'all doing? I'm also good. The last time I saw you, you were lying right next to me. Your body so cold and lifeless, no breath came out to greet me. I shook your dead body to bring you back to life, but you had already left without saying farewell. Dear sis, you don't know how much pain you inflicted, the screams and anger I had to roar out in the rain to reduce my anguish. And when someone was looking at the corners of my teardrops, I had to brush them off with this something in my eye. I had to pick myself up, even when my weight was outside the window. But you don't know all that. I was there too, you know. I faced it all. How dear aunt made us swallow those words as if swallowing smooth yogurt. How we had to dance to the thrills of a fist and camouflage our bodies with brown pastel. Though pain shoved me to the corner with fear, I wore it as if wearing that ugly dress to make it compliment me. I pulled each and every breath and strength out of my bones to run into you, because I could see how you pain my strength out of you. I abandoned me to give you you. It has been 10 years since we last saw, but of all that,
I guess she still haunted you. And now you're doing the same with me. Dear sis, ever since you left, I left myself in that same spot you did. Walked away to build my walls with anti-depression pills, locked my doors with psychologist locks, and put up new curtains on my window with a new personality because I didn't want to accept the invitation from 6 feet under. And as I bring you these flowers, I want to let you know that I'm still renovating. And I'll pick myself up from that same spot once later. Thank you, everybody. Next up, I'd like to call a man from Limpopo, a man you all know very well if you know anything about poetry, Vunani Bila, everyone.
The blinding son of Palabura, countless tales of shame reside. Young and tender Nelson Chisale was an impecunious farm worker. Deranged Mark Scott Crosley, with imperious gaze, was his boss. Chisale didn't own the land. He only came back to the farm to collect his much valued possessions, clothes and pots, perhaps. He did not come to steal or make demands. He did not wield a panga or axe. He did not scheme to strangle or suffocate a settler. He did not plan to slice off the farmer's genitals. He did not have a gun or the intention to blast the white man into the white man's skulls into smithereens. In the blinding sun of Palabora, countless tales of shame reside. We are told, for more than 7 hours, the farmer gulped whiskey and wine, gunned down sumptuous supper, head twirled in murderer's delight, a black body tied to a tree. Hungry and weak, one by one they battered him. His dripping necklace made them do an effervescent jive, and when he wept and moaned, they cut open his flesh, fed their hunger with blood, drank from his flowing wounds, then loaded him into the back of a buggy and drove more than 30 kilometers to Hoedspruit. Dead or alive, only the spirits can tell. They fed his flesh to the lions of Mukwalo. Hungry beasts mauled a black man. One bone this way, another bone that way. One bone this way, another bone that way. Another farm worker murdered. Innocence whirled away, but spirit hovers in the air. I close my eyes, wipe tears of dismay. So many things undone. I drown under the weight of pain. I share the fury of this agonized world. I can only shout, lock the savage in a cold cell for life. Anyway, the savage is out. There is guilt in hate. The rich can't stand in the way of justice and peace forever. In the blinding sun of Palabora, countless tales of shame reside. Some say Scott Crosley was a God-fearing man, a man with a tender heart. Some saw him kiss his new wife splendidly before Judge Maluleke. They also saw breaking rights, severing triumph. What God-fearing man throws his brother to the lions? In the blinding sun of Palabora, countless tales of shame reside. That barbarian is trapped in the ugly past. He is behind bars. Well, now he's out. Prisoners sodomize him every day. He is not blind like a bat, but savage beyond healing. He breathes and multiplies like red steel. Hidden evils roam across Africa's sullen fields. Settlers say they will fight and die for their fatherland. Whose land are they talking about? Greedy souls dance and shit on the graves of my ancestors. Settlers kill a black man who lay huddled. We thought it was a baboon. In the blinding sun of Palabora, countless tales of shame reside. 11 years into liberation, I have no gracious dream. 11 years into liberation, there's no rainbow dance, no straight distance we can walk. 11 years into liberation, I turn and turn in gusts of wind, call on lingering souls of ancestors beneath red earth to pile up wood and stoke fires of Makongoza. Tzika, tzika. 11 years into liberation, wrench free the backs of people hunched at dawn, broken at sundown. Tzika, tzika. 11 years into liberation,
wrench-free working hands of underpaid, regimented workers whose sweat earns them shame in their unreturned land. 11 years into liberation, what I can show the world is a harvest of dust and thorns. 11 years into liberation, what I can show the world is the rural poor's share of the liberation dream sun. A broken light, a broken hoe, a broken hope. 11 years into liberation, one man throws another man to the lions. I can't wait in hope for sudden change, brothers and sisters. The new South Africa is free decay. I will stay in the trenches, I will stay in the combat streets, I will stay to sting, sting like a wasp. Amanda, luta continua.
Thank you, Vunani. The last poet who we can't present here, Vusmuzi Phakathi, just landed. Hustle, hustle. Those who know what I mean know what I mean. but please come and see Vusmuzi on stage doing his 20-minute set on tomorrow. Right, yeah, tomorrow. He'll be on stage tomorrow as a poet from the Vowel Triangle. And that more or less is all the poets that we have to present to you. Before I get off stage, I'd like to say my thank yous. Our funders, eThekwini Municipality, Parks and Recreation and Culture, particularly, National Arts Council, KwaZulu-Natal Department of Arts and Culture, as well as the Goethe Institute. Then I'd like to say thank you, big, big thank you to Adams Booksellers. So the Center for Creative Arts has not had a director for the last 3 years, which is meaning that all of us have been left to our own devices. It's been fun. I'd really like to thank my team, who really, really work hard, who work with a lot of patience and humor, and who are very collaborative in the very true sense. We talk everything to death, literally. So myself, I'm a part of the Center for Creative Arts, Luke Yubert, Mitchell Harper, Musa Sibisi, Nolulamo Makutu, Pumlani Mfekai, Sakile Kumete, Samgelisiwe Mabaso, Sandile Makatini, Sesetu Makina, Setembile, Koza, Sipe, Ndlalana, Spindile, Hlongwa, Tula, Mdlala, Vulani Mtembu, Wanda Mkunu. You guys are the dream team. Thank you. And if it wasn't for Charlene Farsfeld and Ayanda, no one would know. So thank you guys as well. We'd like to thank Artworks for helping us with the layout of this catalogue. Atlas Printers for being flexible with all our deadlines. The team at the Elizabeth Sneddon Theatre, led by Jackie Cuniff, Wesley Mahari, Sue Roberts, Shamla Naidu, as well as Tina, who has just joined. Congratulations on this awesome new job. We'd like to thank Stephanie and Rebecca for stage management and sound. And then we'd like to do a special thanks to Guy Redmond, Eric Applegreen, Bonga Tujana, Sophie Sanan, and a lot of other people who I might not be mentioning, but please understand that everyone is tired and I feel the pressure to get off the stage. Please, can we see you here throughout the week? Come and watch this poetry. I don't like to say come and support the poetry. Come and watch it, because it's good for your health, all right? And come out to the workshop, and let's get together on Saturday. Let's enjoy more poetry, and then let's dance until the end of the day on Saturday when Akane Turi is on stage. Huh? All right. Poets, oh yeah, poets, please stay behind, and everybody please like hashtag PoetryAfrica 2015 on all the social medias. Thank you very much, it's been awesome.